special episode of Neocash Radio. In the studio with you, it's JJ. In this special episode, I'm interviewing the folks behind BarterDEX. I'm talking with Diesmaster, CA333, and PTYtrader. Diesmaster, welcome to the show.
Hi.
As we have CA333, welcome to the show.
Hello, hi, thank you for having us.
And we may have another one joining us as soon as the connection works out, but let's get right into it. And gentlemen, please just give me a little bit of overview about yourselves for a moment and tell our listeners a little bit about you and your history with crypto.
Okay, so I started this crypto because of my dad, since I'm like 16 years old. So he told me a bunch about crypto, then took me to a meetup. Then I did my first investment in Ripple, and then I did some research on separate coins, and I found the Komodo coin. And then while searching about it on Twitter, I saw there was a meetup in Amsterdam, which is in my home country. So I thought that's really nice, and I went there, and now I'm here with SUPERNET.
Okay, excellent. How about you, CA333?
Well, I'm a security expert and developer. I joined the blockchain space around 6 years ago, 5 to 6 years, something like that. I kept doing different jobs in that area, like on contract base. I joined some open source projects and did a lot of like pen testing, vulnerability testing, and ethical hacking, if you want to put it like that.
Okay.
At the end of the last year, end of the last summer, I got to know about the Komodo platform, the upcoming ICO. I started working with the team, actually with James, and after a while, got offered to start working for the SUPERNET organization and project. And thankfully accepted that offer, and since then I'm on board. So at the beginning of this year, I started really full-time. But the collaboration goes back longer. So that's okay. Actually my background.
Yeah. Well, excellent. Well, thank you. We're here to talk about BarterDEX. It's also known as EasyDEX. Is that right?
All right. Yeah, that's true.
Okay. Let's just touch on that. Well, BarterDEX, what is that? Give us an overview and just sort of explain why and what it is.
So BarterDEX is a trustless peer-to-peer decentralized exchange.
Well, yeah, okay. Basically that explains the system.
I mean, that is very, very clear. So BarterDEX, now, what is this run on top? Yeah, what is this run on top of, or what, blockchain? Just give me some idea of what's underneath BarterDEX.
Surface. It is not run on a blockchain, which is a big upside in my opinion, because then if the Komodo chain might die or something happens to it, the BarterDEX will still be okay.
Exactly. Right. So it's basically a fully still decentralized system, and this standalone service, like this much as explained, is like created for order matching, for trade clearing, settlement, and also includes the liquidity provider into a single integrated system. And the really interesting thing is decentralized exchange, from one point of view, makes not pretty clear that we are actually using atomic swaps. So being able to trade coins against each other, still blockchain based. The trades happening blockchain based, so that should be noted. And that's the unique thing actually in it, that we have so-called special transactions. I'll come to them later. And that should give you a clear overview of the BarterDEX, and it's
so this is multi-chains, multi-currencies. What currencies does this support atomic swaps of? Can you give me some examples?
Yeah, at this moment it supports about 250 different coins, and they can be traded in any pair as long as one of them has a 2 of 2 multi-sign transaction wallet and the other one a time lock.
So basically, is there, you know, is this a smart contract driven experience, or how does this? I mean, we'll get into the details of it, but
actually, good that you mentioned it. It is some sort of a smart contract. The nature of these transactions taking place to fulfill an atomic swap, they are based on the BYP16, a so-called pay-to-script hash, which allows you sending funds to a script hash, like that are those addresses starting with a 3, so all multi-sig addresses, and using that instead of a public key hash. And with those special transactions, you could actually say, I'll add like conditions to the or a time lock, so it won't be spendable before reaching a certain block count or time span. And then those transactions also are a reveal on secret transaction, which means like once you send somebody a transaction, it will also not only include value but also data information. And in that sense, it's part of a private key of a signature, which allows the trading partner to in the end fulfill do the spend, and that's also actually the part where the settlement takes place. It's a little part of like if you do one atomic swap, just let me count. We have a deposit. Okay, we have a deposit. DEX fee, the Alice payment, Bob payment, Alice spent, Bob spent, and then the refund of the deposit. So we have 7 transactions taking place.
Okay.
And the way the transactions are formed, like without going too much into detail, they actually are some sort of logic. Not just a procedure it is happening, there is a logic. There is a if and when. So in my eyes, it is already like some sort of smart logic on the blockchain. It's not necessarily a contract, but it's there.
Excellent. Well, we have right now, as long as the connection holds up, we have PTY Trader joining us. PTY, welcome to the show. Are you there?
Hi, how are you?
PTY, why don't you just briefly, just to catch folks up, tell us a little about yourself and your sort of involvement in the BarterDEX.
Well, first of all, I'm the SuperNet lead support, so I'm in charge pretty much of helping everyone all the time. That's my main role. I make guides, videos. I'm also an active tester. Aside from that, I'm a notary node operator. Recently, I've been working on the BarterDEX. So the testing has moved from the command line testing that we were doing about a month ago to GUI testing that we're using now. It's the, I guess if you want to call it like a beta GUI, a BarterDEX app. So you have the market maker binaries that are running on the client node. And instead of communicating with them through the command line, we use ugly GUI is what we're calling it right now. It's just like a basic shape shift type GUI, so you can make swaps with it. No command line is needed for it, and you can deposit the coins that you want to trade against. And that's pretty much how we're going to start getting new users into the BarterDEX as we move forward.
Okay, cool. Well, let me step through the user experience now, and we'll start right at the top, sort of following along with the white paper if you at home are listening and want to follow along. We're going to start with how the order matching works, and this is sort of the first experience that someone's going to have using this protocol. So tell us a little bit about the order matching process.
Do you mean from beginning to end?
We're going to step through each of the different parts. I don't know if you got a note of the questions, but just to start with how the order matching works, that the fact that you're hosting it on servers and things like that.
Okay, sure. Go ahead, CA.
Okay, just a moment. Yeah, the order matching. So maybe important to know that there are like order matching servers which we run. There's a little bit of trust put on them, but it's tiny, and like they do not control any funds, but instead really only provide the order matching services. Like PTY, do you wanna explain the rest? Like you place an order, gets broadcasted. other network participants and BarterDEX users have a order book.
Okay.
Which, like, the order propagation gets in, and you then basically are able to initiate such a trade in a very, very simple manner. That's what actually PTYtrader has been, like, testing a lot, and also gave a lot of support for that. So he'll just, like, jump to that section when, like, actually really what do you have to do as a user
to get the
order matching.
For example, once you're a user, and let's say that they're going to be using the BarterDEX app that we have, the ugly GUI now, all they would have to do is just install the app. They would have to make sure that they have the deposits that they want to trade, depending on the trade pair. And they would have to make sure they have the 1/777th fee, which is charged per transaction. So, for example, if you were trading 1 KMD for the equal of BTC, you would have to have 1.007 KMD or something like that. Once you have the amounts in the addresses, all you would have to do is just click on the order on the current orders that are available. You would set the price, the amount, click swap, and everything in the background would take place, which would be the actual order matching process. But the user is not going to see any of that. He would just see the GUI.
Okay. Okay, so you're saying it's sort of like a shapeshift, but with an order book.
Exactly, yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, in a way, it's
Which fully is decentralized.
Right, like, what, shapeshift obviously isn't decentralized, but sort of like the user experience is you're saying I want to swap these coins, and then you go to and there's an order book of awaiting potential swaps available, and then you're like, okay, well, I want to pick this one.
Exactly. Well, currently, when you log into it, for example, if you want to trade Komodo for Bitcoin, you'll see a list of the buy orders and the sell orders. That way, you'll be able to pick which one you want. And when you you input the amounts and you click swap, it should go right away if it's one of the orders that's on the book already. So it's pretty similar to just picking an order from an order book and fulfilling it. Hello?
I can hear you.
Oh, okay. I thought I cut out again.
I can't hear him.
Are you there, Neocash?
Neocash?
Yeah, I'm still here. It says my connection with PTYtrader has failed. But please play. It's still recording on your side, even if I can't hear you.
Oh, okay, yeah.
All right.
Edit it all together. I'm going to cut out all of these annoying times where we're like, I can't hear you or whatever. So
perfect.
Don't worry about that. We'll make sure it sounds good in the end here at New.
Okay, it should sound good because I pretty much finished. So
excellent, good. If you don't hear me, it's because you went out while I was listening, and I can't tell when you finished. So
okay.
This is worldwide communications. So this is basically this is atomic swap. This is one person putting up an order and then another person responding, and then the two swap directly with each other. Is that right?
Right.
Exactly.
Whether that's someone, let's say a sole trader or a liquidity provider.
Okay. So now let's get into the liquidity providers, because that's our next question. How do liquidity providers have a place in this market, and what do they do?
Well, one of the big things about centralized exchanges is that the funds are centralized as well. So you have to depend on, for example, if you want to create an exchange, you have to depend on banks or investors or whatnot in order to get the capital to trade. But with the liquidity provider servers, anyone with just a minimum amount of capital is going to be able to provide liquidity for any pair that they decide to provide liquidity for. So, for example, if you have $10,000 and you decide you want to provide liquidity for Dash, you set up your liquidity provider node, you fill it with Dash, you calibrate it, and you will automatically provide liquidity for the BarterDEX. So, in a sense, we're decentralizing where the funds are coming from. And that's really only like the basics of it, because that same liquidity provider can actually buy from a centralized exchange and arbitrage trade it back to the BarterDEX and make profit that way too. So there's
Exactly, moving volume from a lot the of centralized exchange to the decentralized ones.
Exactly, without us losing the decentralization.
And
go ahead.
Well, yeah, and apart from that, just to explain it from a little bit technical perspective, there are like special nodes we develop with like have an integrated automated trade balancing. They are not really needed to run the BarterDEX. So they are just like a great feature for the ecosystem and for the security. And you're able to configure it, like specify a specific profit margin. And your LP node will then like automatically respond to user trade requests, which then are based on the best available price. Let's say like you put a 1% profit on it, you will be like competing with all other like liquidity providers. So it will always be like a best price based at that moment in time you are like gonna match an order. And
now, if you can specify which pairs you want to trade, like which ones, like if
for example, let's say I'll let my LP run on like Jumbler, for example, and say it has like will have like a 1% profit margin, so we'll like provide Jumblers to the decentralized exchange with a 1% profit base for myself. And yeah, and like I am, like I've all mentioned, all nodes like are competing with each other to create like
an open market,
a market competition. Yeah, so no single node has like an advantage over the other traders. So
now, do you have like so we covered sort of that. Do you have like an oracle, a price oracle built in, or how do the nodes know what a profit price is and that sort of thing?
CA.
Yeah. Okay. Well, price. Same thing. We have like a price fee, which gets broadcasted in intervals, and that's where like the whole BarterDEX orientated set, and also like a SuperNet Iguana core. If you like trying to get a price feed, yeah.
All right. Yeah.
That's how we do it.
All right. So finally,
centralized. That's what like we like take care of. So we don't connect to one central exchange and read the price from there, and then that's not like how we do it. That would be like a huge risk.
Right. Yeah, I mean, there are some exchanges, especially when you look at them nowadays, if you pick some of the Korean and Chinese exchanges, they're paying 10% or more above what other exchanges are paying for a coin. So
maybe just to clear this apart, like from, for example, like the so-called fiat assets we have.
Okay.
We have like notary notes connecting to the European Central Bank and get reading the price from there. But that's just because we support fiat tokens in our network. So we said, that's like the most reliable source to get the price fit for fiat currencies. But the pure blockchain-based ones are like fully decentralized.
Okay. So we pretty much covered the trade clearing and settlement and the atomic cross-chain swap that happens. Now, so basically you're saying this BarterDEX it has to be a wallet for all of these 250-plus currencies. Is that right?
Well, currently there are not like 250 fully.
Or do you link it up to a different wallet that you own?
So in order, you need native or you need a full node to run a wallet. For example, like if you use the BarterDEX GUI and you activate Komodo, it's going to activate the Komodo daemon. So you actually have to run the full node for it, to trade that pair, to trade that coin. For someone who would want to trade Digibyte, they would activate Digibyte, and then they would have to download the blockchain and sync and everything.
Okay.
So it's all done natively, which is, I think, one of the points some of the decentralized exchanges we see now, they're using proxy tokens. We're using native blockchains.
So now, is this there? I see the word Agama in BarterDEX sort of put together. Is that a wallet that you can use with this?
Yeah,
is that...
Agama is our multi wallet. It's like our flagship multi wallet.
All right, excellent.
In the future, the vision is to have all these services within Agama. So, you know, maybe a year from now, you'll be able to use the BarterDEX, maybe the Jumbler and all of these other features within the wallet.
Okay. Now, as far as the BarterDEX development and the company and funding and whatnot, is this other than the fee, the 1777th fee, this is so anyone can use this service without holding a certain token or a bank paying for some subscription. Is that right?
Right, that's correct.
And so there is, and then basically the BarterDEX, what's your roadmap going for? Like you mentioned again, a wallet and whatnot. What sort of, you know, you're like, oh, my dream, the dream vision is in like a year, we'll be able to do this, that, and the other thing, right? Like that sort of thing.
Well, it's hard to calculate times because, you know, there's a lack of developers and we have so many things that are ready to go into GUI development, but, you know, we are lacking the necessary people to push all of these things forward at once. So it's hard to say if it's going to be a year, 6 months or 2 years, but I think we have a clear plan ahead of integrating all of these services that are now separate or they might seem separate are all going to be joined into one, you know, working application.
Right.
And yeah, I mean, as for the BarterDEX, from my perspective, you know, it's going to mature into something that all traders are going to want to use because it's not only going to allow them to become liquidity providers for whatever coin pair they mine or they want to sell. It'll allow them to make profits, whether it's through arbitrage trading. I mean, there's so many possibilities with the LP nodes and the services that the LP nodes can provide. You know, it's pretty amazing.
We also, for traders, we also have the quantum offer or the quantum, which is a technology where you can place an order for multiple coins with the same Bitcoin.
Oh, that's a liquidity multiplier. Yeah, it's something James has been working on. So basically, if you have 100 Bitcoins, right, you'll be able to place an order of 100 Bitcoins against Dash and against Ether and against whichever other coin is going to be traded in the BarterDEX. And whichever order is fulfilled first cancels out the rest. So you'll be able to provide liquidity, in a sense, to all these other coins with the same capital. Most exchanges don't do that or have never even thought about doing that.
Well, yeah, I wonder how some of these exchanges are really run, though. I don't, you know, there's no coins moving in the background. When I go on
to
any of these, it's just numbers in a spreadsheet. So as far as that, and what sort of accountability, what sort of audit can I do on the exchange to make sure that they're using the correct number of tokens that they have in their holdings? You know, those sorts of questions come up.
Right. I think there was a case not too long ago. I saw it on the news. It was one of the big Asian exchanges. They were using the funds of the users to invest in the background.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That was the Korean exchange. That.
You know, so I mean, like, how can you
stop? Apart from that, I think, like, more interestingly, especially BarterDEX, once it gets really mature and stable, I don't have a problem seeing centralized exchanges setting the service up based on BarterDEX. They would basically just be the liquidity provider and like configure, specify their profit margin they want to do. And yeah, actually users could use their own decentralized application to trade against them. So it could be even used in a centralized form and ensuring like maximum transparency and security. And to get back to the roadmap you were asking for, so actually like stabilizing, optimizing the BarterDEX and the technologies it relies on, like Iguana networking part and different other things, that's like a main thing we're working on, and then getting out a very good developed BarterDEX graphical user interface. I mean,
so that's the holdup right now is the graphical user interface. But so you've been running this, testing this. What sort of development phase are you in? Are you in a closed beta, or what's the stage right now?
Yeah, the state right now is it's a closed beta. That's the best thing to describe it. Going towards release candidate, but there are multiple development teams working on it. Like I am in contact with two, who like are regularly touching base and asking questions. And I built a little team. Like I, a C developer I hired some time ago, and a friend, a graphic guy. We are working on a BarterDEX, a graphical user interface implementation, to participate in the BarterDEX GUI bounty.
Okay. Well, it's. Go ahead.
Yeah, and I think there are like more coming. Like I think there will be a lot of graphical user interfaces for our BarterDEX system. I'm pretty sure, like starting with mobile implementations and going through all operating systems and stuff.
Yeah, mobile seems the way things are going. I mean, there are places in the world where people only have mobile access to...
Yeah, we're at like plus 75% now,
yeah.
Mobile access.
Yeah, it's huge. And then there are messaging apps that allow you to go and browse and do things more than just messaging. So it just seems like that's the way to go. But it seemed the whole idea of running a full node blockchain and running it in a mobile environment is sort of, you know, SPV wallets and things like that. It'll have to be integrated somehow in some way.
That's also where SuperNet comes in place. Like we have a network system, which like allows you to interact between different cryptocurrencies without relying on a full blockchain sync and like actually making things easier. But we're still like developing it. It's not that mature to say, okay, it's like ready for mainstream adoption. So.
Yeah, and even when it is, we'll probably give an option to, whether you want to use a light network or the full node network.
Exactly, especially for mobile integration, that is very interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, excellent. So do you have, obviously there's a lot of time involved. Do you have like an idea of when you expect the next phase like to open up to more users trying it out, or even the, you know, the next release candidate or an actual full release? Any idea of time frame?
Well, it depends. Talking now about the BarterDEX integration.
Okay.
BarterDEX graphical user interface, that is still in development. Like before... Actually, the version with BarterDEX comes out, there will be like a version which just includes a wallet, native wallet implementation.
Okay.
And based on that wallet implementation, there will be like a BarterDEX tab, if you want to put it like that. So it will be like a combined software, actually, because it's still relying on Komodo. That's what I want, to have a Komodo integration straight with BarterDEX. So actually users not having to mess around with coin diamonds. And
I appreciate you guys taking the time and explaining this to me. I think I definitely have a better idea of what's going on now. So thank you very much. Thank you, Diesmaster, for coming.
Thank you for having me.
And CA333.
Thank you very much. Pleasure on our side. Thank you.
And I'm PTYtrader. Thank you so much.
You as well. Have a great day.
You're listening to a special episode of Neocash Radio. Check out our website at neocashradio.com.